A very warm good morning to all the delegates. By now, you are deep into session 7, public interest litigation in environment cases. I acknowledge the chair, Honorable Judge of the Supreme Court of Thailand, the session facilitator, Honorable Judge of the Supreme Court of Philippines, my preceding speakers from the Federal Court of Malaysia, the Supreme Court of Indonesia, the Supreme Court of Thailand, and the Supreme Court of Philippines. And now, permit me to present a paper on the public interest litigation in India relating to environment cases. I may start by stating that a predominant part of the existing environment law has developed in India through careful judicial thinking in the Supreme Court and the High Courts. While exercising their powers under Article 32 and 226 of the Constitution of India, both the Supreme Court and the High Courts respectively have played a pivotal role in interpreting Article 21, which is a right to life, for redressal of environmental grievances. The courts have successfully evolved indigenous juristic techniques by incorporating various international doctrines relating to environment for purposes of interpreting the Constitution and the statutes, combined with a liberal view towards ensuring social justice and the protection of human rights as a part of the environmental jurisprudence of India. The most characteristic feature of the Indian environmental law is the important role played by public interest litigations, in short PILs. A majority of the environmental cases in India since the year 1985 have been brought before the courts as writ petitions, normally by individuals acting on a pro bono basis. Public interest litigation is a result of the relaxation of the locus standi rule. This is a departure from the proof of injury approach, and this form is usually efficient in dealing with environmental cases for the simple reason that these cases are concerned with the rights of the community rather than the individual. The judiciary looked into constitutional provisions to provide the court with the necessary jurisdiction to address specific issues. Disputes that are normally matters of torts in other common law jurisdictions are treated as cases pertaining to fundamental rights in India. Though the fundamental rights are enshrined in Part 3 of the Constitution of India, and they do not specifically mention environmental matters, but the courts have held that Article 21 of the Constitution entitles a citizen to invoke the writ jurisdictions of the Supreme Court and the High Courts under Article 32 and 226. These remedies have proven to be very powerful tools and assisted in redressing environmental grievances because they provide for direct access to the High Courts and the Supreme Court of India, and in the process eliminate expenses and delay of normal appeals. In India, in the past 2.5 decades, environmental law has evolved at a very fast pace and established a number of fundamental principles for its better implementation. A major share of this innovation can be attributed to the Indian judiciary, particularly the higher judiciary comprising of the Supreme Court of India and the High Courts of the different states, and now the National Green Tribunal that was activated in the year 2010 on the basis of a statute by incorporating various international doctrines relating to environment as a part of the environmental jurisprudence of India. The concept of PIL has facilitated access to justice for all classes of the society, be they rich or poor, educated or illiterate, an individual or an entire community, to that extent even an NGO. The Indian judiciary has upheld the doctrine of public trust. The orders and directions of the Supreme Court and the High Courts at the state level cover a wide range of areas, be it air, water, solid waste or hazardous waste. The field covers areas such as vehicular pollution, pollution by industries, depletion of forests, illegal felling of trees, conservation of wildlife, dumping of hazardous waste, solid waste management, plastic degradation, pollution of rivers, illegal mining. The list is unending. The Supreme Court has passed several orders for closure of polluting industries and environmentally harmful aqua farms. It has mandated cleaner fuel for vehicles, stopped illegal mining activity, protected forests and preserved architectural treasures like the Taj Mahal, which you saw in my presentation yesterday. It has also prohibited construction of activities in sensitive areas like sanctuaries. A plethora of PILs are filed regularly before the Supreme Court and the High Courts, and they have played an important role in creating environmental jurisprudence. Due to paucity of time, I'm referring only to a few of the landmark cases relating to preservation of environment, starting with the Ratlam Municipal Council case. This was a case that came up in the year 1980, where the municipal body of the city of Ratlam had failed to perform its duty of ensuring establishment of a proper drainage system on the grounds of paucity of funds. The Supreme Court in this case had introduced the concept of PIL for the first time and had observed that a responsible municipal council constituted for the precise purpose of preserving public health cannot escape from its primary duty by pleading financial inability. Ever since then, the Indian judiciary has been evolving old principles and formulating new ones to meet the need of the hour. A perfect example is the case of Mr. M.C. Mehta, where in the year 1987, the Supreme Court dealt with a case of oleum gas leakage in an industrial plant in the city of Delhi in the year 1985 that had led to the death of a person and had raised serious health issues in the general population. In this case, the Supreme Court had introduced the doctrine of absolute liability on the users of hazardous material, thereby eroding the possibility of the offending party taking any defense to wriggle out of the accountability. This rule was evolved on the established principle of strict liability. In a case that was decided by the Supreme Court in the year 1992, known as the Tarun Bharat Sangh, a distinguished NGO had filed a PIL in 1991 regarding large-scale mining activities illegally sanctioned by the state government within the protected area that was steadily destroying the tiger habitat and was pushing them towards virtual extinction. The Supreme Court directed the constitution of a committee headed by a retired Supreme Court judge to prepare a list of mines within the protected area and to ensure that enforcement of the notifications and the orders of the court are implemented strictly. It prohibited all mining activities in the Sariskar National Park, and the area was notified as a tiger reserve. In the year 96, the Chief Justice of India established a permanent forest bench to deal with cases relating to environment and forests. In the year 2013, the forest bench was rechristened as the Green Bench, and it continues to oversee matters relating to sanctuaries and national parks, as these matters do not fall within the jurisdiction of the recently established National Green Tribunal. The Indian judiciary has the unenviable task of drawing a fine balance between environmental concerns and competing demands of development that generates employment and adds to the national wealth. Keeping that in mind, in the case of Vellore Citizens Welfare Forum, the Supreme Court had invoked the polluters pay principle. Here, the untreated effluents of tanneries and industries were being directly discharged in River Palar. That was the main source of water supply to the residents of the city of Vellore in Tamil Nadu. The Supreme Court held the absolute liability principle for harm caused to the environment extends not only to compensate the victims of pollution, but also to cover the costs of restoring environmental degradation. Next comes the Research Foundation for Science and Technology case in the year 2005, where the petitioners had filed a PIL in the Supreme Court, invoking the fundamental rights of a citizen enshrined under Article 21 of the Constitution of India, and asking for prevention of a French ship from entering the Alang shipbreaking yard situated in the state of Gujarat on the ground that it was posing a threat to the maritime environment. The Supreme Court had responded instantly by issuing a direction denying access to the ship to make port at the shipbreaking yard for purposes of dismantling. Showing deep concern over the operation of shipbreaking, the court had asked for recommendations from a committee of technical experts constituted by it. Directions were also issued to the Government of India to enact a legislation on this aspect as an interim measure. The court had laid down a set of guidelines to be followed in order to mitigate the harm caused to the environment by this activity, which included decontamination of a ship prior to its breaking and classification of the waste generated by the shipbreaking process into hazardous and non-hazardous. Lastly, I would like to refer to a case known as Himparvesh Environment Protection Society versus State of Himachal Pradesh. In the year 2010, petitions were filed before the High Court of Himachal Pradesh challenging the setting up of a cement plant by an industrial house in District Solan of Himachal Pradesh, which is a hilly area, alleging that the cement plant had been set up in total violation of the environmental law, especially the EIA notifications. The plant had demolished a good part of the forest area and taken lands from nearby villagers without providing a proper public hearing. Conscious of the fact that passing of a closure or demolition order in respect of the already constructed cement plant would cause immense hardship and adversely affect the livelihood of thousands of the innocent citizens, the High Court had invoked the principles of polluters pay and imposed damages on the cement plant owner to the tune of 100 crores, that is about 25% of the total value of the project. This decision was challenged by the cement plant owner before the Supreme Court, but the appeal came to be dismissed in the year 2013. I may add here that in order to provide effective and expeditious disposal of cases pertaining to environmental protection and forest conservation, the National Green Tribunal was established in the year 2010. The National Green Tribunals Act vests the tribunal with jurisdiction over all civil cases relating to water, forest, air, environment, and biological diversity, where a substantial question relating to environment is involved. Appeals against these orders lie in the Supreme Court. So now we have two fora that are dealing with the issues relating to environment, both before the Supreme Court and the High Court, and lastly before the NGT. To sum up, the Indian judiciary has proved to be a strategic partner in promoting environmental governance, upholding the rule of law, and in ensuring that a fair balance is placed between protection of environment, social commitments, and developmental considerations of our country. Thank you for your patience. I hope the slides that you had an opportunity to look at enhance the experience in my absence before you.